why use Zapfino? Well, Zapfino is not really a font that you will use in your daily practice to typeset documents, unless I think that Wendy always does everything in Zapfino, but that's an exception. Now the reason, one of the reasons that I've been playing quite a bit with Zapfino is that first of all, Amazon gave me the font, so I had a good reason to play with it. And the second is that especially the pro version, is a very extensive font. Okay, let's go back a bit first to what LuaTech is doing with fonts. There's an open type font reader, and the font reader is borrowed from FontWatch. It means that, well, somehow FontWatch has an idea about what an open type font is, and the more or less similar representation is available in LuaTech. So once we had a reader and then get a table, a Lua table, you can actually look into the font. Normally the way to look into a font is you start FontWatch or whatever, and you try to figure out what the characteristics of the font or the characters or whatever are. But, well, I'm more accustomed to looking at a file and a more or less database-oriented something, so we could finally look into the font. It's going too fast. The problem with OpenType is that the specification is, well, it's called OpenType, but the specification, I won't say it's closed, but it's close to closed. You need a lot of reading, trying to imagine what I meant, and actually you need fonts in order to understand what they are doing there. Now, when we implemented playing with the Zapfino stuff, we actually found out that FontForge was internally representing the font in such a way that a lot of information wasn't even available. It somehow lost information along the route. It took us a while to figure that out. Yet another problem is that, he has already mentioned that in his talk. You know, if you look at a simple text font, it's just characters. They have pretty simple characteristics like a width and height and depth, and that's about it. And so, well, there cannot be much wrong with such a font. An open type font contains a lot of information which normally is generated by scripts, and font designers are not programmers. I'd like to say, you know, how many font designers use MetaFont? Yeah, it's way over the head. They are font designers, not programmers. And the same is a bit true with OpenType. The font designer is probably not the one who is going to implement all the features of which I will show in a few moments. So it depends on other person. They normally do scripting, and if you do scripting, well, a simple typo can mess up your font. Well, one of the things that we found out when playing with Zapfino was that there are bugs in the font, and we had to go back to the guy who was responsible for adding the features, who we happen to know because he is rather familiar with the tech world, and we occasionally meet him at Bachotech. But even then, you enter a whole area. What will happen? Can you get an update from LuaTech for free? Is there an update program for that? How do they know that? How do you get to know that the font is changed? So this is a bit of a fuzzy area. Oops. Then we changed to FontForge version 2, and we suddenly got all the information that we needed in order to typeset the Zapfino. Well, properly is again an interpretation, because you never know if you do the thing right. Okay. At the same time, using such a complex font, if you serialize the tables to files, we are talking about, let's say that an average Latin modern, which has some 600 glyphs, on disks takes, in a readable format, some 600 kilobytes. then one of those complex fonts easily takes 50 megabytes. We talk about really huge fonts. So it makes sense then to say, well, is all information in there needed? Nope, throw it away. All things that, that more or less default to zero, throw them away, things like that. That helps a lot. For instance, for the advanced Arab font that, that Edith mentioned, we could more or less halve the size of the files involved. Okay, making it work. So what happens? At some moment, and again, what I'm saying here is not the solution, it's a solution. FontFirst library loads the font into memory. At that moment, it still gives, well, basically, I think a lot of packed bytes are turned into C structs. The internal data structures are then mapped onto a Lua table. You can request it, and you get back a big table. We talk about huge tables. What we do in, at least at my end of the game, is we enhance this code a bit. You know, if you really want to manipulate your stream of glyphs, it helps if you have fast access to some of the characters of fonts. So we do a bit of analysis and add additional tables. Then we save this huge table. We're talking about, in this case, about really the 30 to 50 megabytes. Save them in what we call a font cache. We compile them to bytecode, which reduces them to a couple of megabytes in this case. And then they can be loaded real fast. That's one interesting thing about Lua. I don't know how they did it, but it's really fast in loading and constructing big tables. And it's actually faster than to load those new tables than to load a font again in FontForge. When we define such a font, you can imagine if you have a font in several instances, this scale and that scale, search features enabled, it makes sense to share data. So we share as much data as possible. And finally, the OpenType specific table is translated into something that tech can handle, just characters. And now comes the interesting part. What tech can do with fonts is actually well limited. Currents and ligatures is about everything that's possible. But when you have to deal with features, well, there are, I don't know the exact number, but we are talking about hundreds of features. And they need to be applied selectively. And tech doesn't have the information to, it's not built into the engine to store this. So as soon as you start implementing this kind of things, you say, forget about tech currents, forget about tech ligatures, let's do it in Lua. Can still be done, but we don't do it. Okay. How does it look from the user's end of the game? Well, because you can, as Taco demonstrated, you can intercept the font definition. You basically get a font name passed. It means that you can also interpret this font name and, well, do things with it. So, for instance, if you look at the way that Xiter fonts are defined with the specification directly following the font name, it's easy to intercept that and to provide a Xiter compatible interface. I'm not saying that it's behaving the same way as Xiter because it needs, but it, at least because that's what in the last couple of years, as we mentioned, can we make something like this at least Xiter compatible? So. At the macro packet level, we provide higher level interfaces to defining features and in more abstract ways and associating that with response. What I'm planning is, but it may take a while, is most of this functionality, once you've written it, is not really dependent on macro packages. So I can make it generic, but it probably takes a bit of time to reach the point that they say, okay, this is the kind of interface that you want to these kind of things. Another thing is that, as I showed in the previous talk, this French stuff, well, it is somehow related to a language, maybe related to a font, especially if you talk about the dimensions involved. These are normally not covered in OpenType font. So even if you support certain OpenType features, you still have to add additional processing of in this case node list at model level. Well, one of the nice things about the reader that Marco wrote, there's also a variant which is really fast and can be used to quickly identify all the fonts, so we can use the more verbose font names known to the system. The downside of all this stuff is that, well, life used to be simple. Tech user loads a font and that's it. But suddenly the user has to be aware that the font has certain properties, and the nasty thing about the OpenType specification is that, well, it's not entirely clear which features should be on by default. Some are explicitly mentioned and others have these, well, recommendation kind of things. So, well, for context, I'm still wondering, should I enable certain things, but should I enable liberty by default, or should I leave everything to the user to define? This is something that really needs to be decided. Okay, Zapfino. We really needed this exercise because eventually we had to do ARP, and ARP is not well. I can recognize by now some of the shape, but reading or speaking is way beyond me. And Zapfino at least is a script thing, and I can read it. We also use it because it's a pretty good testbed. It uses many features, especially, as I will show in the file later, all kinds of contextual lookup features. As I already mentioned, the LuaTeX tables are rather large, and there can be, well, we talk about really hundreds of lookups per character as soon as you start analyzing the screen. So say that you have a word like there, or a few words like there can be, you look at the B of can be, but you have to look back and forward in order to see what's the environment of this character in order to decide what the B should actually become. Well, I already mentioned that. Another complication is that you don't really know how the output is supposed to look. Of course, you can say, okay, I use Apple, one of those Apple editors that automatically turn your Zapfino into something readable, you cheat there or you whatever, but actually you don't really know because there can be a bug in the font, and there actually was a bug in the font, as I mentioned. The funny thing is the bug was actually, you know, Herman Zapf is the author of Zapfino, and the HZ combination turned out into an H only at a certain point. And kind of maybe they were punishing the master for making such a complex font. And another thing is that as soon as you do the thing by manipulating loaders, you must make sure that text auto mechanism doesn't spoil the game. For instance, if the sample that I will show, you enable tech ligation hyphenation mechanism, you are really in trouble because tech tries to decompose and recompose things. Now, how do you do that with this complex characters? It can be that if you hyphenate, actually you would, given the font definitions, need a completely different combination of glyphs. And this is something non-trivial. Another special thing is that many of those lookups, they look back and forth over spaces. Well, tech doesn't have a space, yeah. But what exactly is the definition of a space? Is the beginning of a word, should we consider that a space or not? If there's an H-box in between, is the H-box itself, let's say, should you have a sort of kind of virtual space at the beginning or the end of the... There's some fake areas. Okay, before I will show this font, I will show you how the Zapfino, how such a big table looks. So, it starts with a bit of general information. So this is a character, that's a complete stupid character. OK.
go to some more.
Wait, they will see something here that there is 8. It has to bit, it has Unicode encoding point. As you see here, there are all kinds of subtables, and the subtables more or less define what the what lookup values are. Lookups is, it, you see it as in searches, that say that you decide that you should use in regular form old sound numerals instead of normal ones, then the feature somehow points back to the cliff definition and say, okay, internally I have tagged the feature this like this, and find the associated representation of this cliff. Just to give you an idea. So we have to manipulate this kind of tables. These are examples of contextual analysis. So all these the four preceding characters, if they match one of these, then for certain, no, this is actually current. If these sequences, let's say 0, fraction 0, 0, is found, then it has to become, in this case, I guess it has to be a Pramil sign. Yeah. So all these things, and you don't know which one, because it has to look at the cliff actually to see which one is selected. Interesting thing is that this assumes actually some knowledge of the language, yeah? Which is why a lot of these features are language related. So here, if there's a sequence of these three characters preceding it, you here see the space. So there's two spaces before, and then a B. Well, what's two spaces in there? Then probably, I guess that this I will have something very big that will go under the preceding thing. And also, there can be something after it. So is, there's probably a very special ligature for is, for these special situations. Okay. This is more or less how a subfino renders when you don't do anything, which is already kind of okay, I think. So I will just, this is when some ligatures are applied. These are the default ligatures. Contextual ligatures, so it's still not so much. Now it becomes really different. Yeah. Now you get the contextual analysis, especially look at the word highlight, for instance. Yeah, which comes out completely different now. You somehow, there are certain words that really, yeah. You see how the D often changes, F's change. I'm trying to make it more connected. This is actually, I think, this is the ligature. There's quite some contextual lookup for that one. So make sure that in certain situations it really becomes the, but you don't want this one if it's part of a word. And I find some words which has this thing. And here we have enabled all of them, so it's not even a bit different. Again, it I think it's also a bit of taste what you enable in this kind of thing. But as I said, I'm absolutely not sure if this is correct. If you talk about the number of lookups, if they total up to I think 700 or 800, and if you put on tracing and you run it and you look at the amount of things that is looked at, well, and again, there's the concept of space. How do you treat space? I'm pretty sure that Xeter has the same problem, that somehow you have to decide something, or maybe you have to make it configurable or somehow. But this is really a challenge.
Show it to Vermont.
Yeah, we can ask the master. Okay. So what I want to do is make a quick switch to error. How long did it use? Still a few minutes to go. Okay. Either it showed error type, which is a Microsoft font. which I think you can just download and use, isn't it?
If you have Vista, technically it comes with Vista or Microsoft Office proofing tools.
Yesterday we found out that if you want to have the Mars, the Cambrian Mars, it seems to be included in the PowerPoint previewer. So you just download the Okay. So this font has many advanced Arab related features. In addition to Zapfino, it has a lot of additional kerning and positioning going on, as I will show later. The vowels, this is a bit of a complex thing. There are quite some vowels, as Idris showed in his input. You have something like character vowel, 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 character vowel, vowel, vowel. And whatever you do with these characters, the vowels need somehow to travel along with the character. There's even relative positioning of vowels. Oh, I'm already. Okay, so one of the first things that we have to do with Arab is, and this is an this is where OpenType and basically the processor that you use to handle the OpenType divide their task. Is there is something like you can for Arab you need to change the character if it's a at the beginning, the middle, or the end of the verb, or if it's an isolated character. And in order to do that, you have to know what is the beginning of a word. Yeah? And OpenType does tell you that. So in this case, there need to be some language-specific analyses for doing that. So what we for this kind of stuff, we use colors to check if the analysis is somehow correct. And it's really bit of a problem because, well, it's not our native language, so we need that guy to and normally that guy is, well, on the other side of the world.
No, you're on the other side of the world.
You're on the other side. But I know that when the phone rings at 1 o'clock I should not answer. I think about you phoned me out with Ben twice, yeah? Okay, so this is what happens if we replace these characters with the initial and the finals. I think it's already looks a bit Arab, yeah? Now we're going to position the marks. You see how the vowels change positions, yeah? You have to change them relatively to each other sometimes. Let me see if there's... It's visible here. Well, it's actually not visible. It's going through the middle, yeah? You see, it comes up now. This is very subtle. This is cursive positioning. So now the characters are being connected. Yeah? For Urdu, I think maybe you recognize the very slanted stuff, but this it's not in this font, is it?
It is, but it's subtle, but it's there.
The last word you see is...
Yeah, the very last word, the bottom on the right.
Yeah, but isn't it really going?
Some letters yes, some letters no. But in Urdu, that's true as well, oddly enough. So it's the same model.
Here we have a little bit of kerning, so you see that you can see that the line break changes a bit. This is contextual analysis. Not that much going on. Ligatures. But again, you get all kinds of different outputs, and for us it's kind of, well... I think Paco and I really spent lots of time also figuring out what the OpenSpike type spec actually means. If there are things like in the flags in the special case, okay, ignore vowels, and it's part of lookup, so should they be ignored when you do the lookup? Should they be ignored when you do the replacement? You have to really, and trial and error is for us the only way to do it. But this is actually the last one, but much of it is applied. Even then you can, I think, and this is what Idris mentioned about the... About the quality of the font, when it's a finished small thingy, it's now completely gone.
Go down. Right there, that's it.
Oh. Why don't I get the... Yeah, it really takes us quite... Because the first thing that we think, oh, looks like some tilde, some funny tilde is being taken. You have to go into the font, you have to follow the table, you have to see what happens, and you finally found out that it's more or less a bug in the font. You see here, yeah, well, is this positioned right? I think it probably is conforming the definition. But visually, I can imagine that you... This is the kind of detail that Iris wants, that will have additional provisions and say, okay, in this particular cases, you can overload the open type specification and move it slightly the direction. Okay, so this is more or less what I wanted to show. The interesting thing is that, okay, if you can do this, these features, you can probably do all the other ones too. There's, however, a class of features that we didn't touch yet, and they have to do with things that should happen at the end or the beginning of a line. But then you have to be at next stage and say, okay, now I have split lines and now I have to do these things. Actually, the number of really different features is not even that large. There are really funny features like change this one character if a language is Syriac or something like that. Really, I think maybe 25% falls in the category of if you can handle these or these, you can handle them all. So this is a bit of a short story about how it goes. If you want to know how code looks that deals with this, let's forget about all kind of clever catching tricks that we use. And what you have to do is, it's a loop that looks a bit like we had before. You look at the glyph, and if the glyph, you handle them by, in this case, we run over the list by font. For each font we do a pass over the list. And it really keeps surprising me how fast it is in practice. That if you even start thinking about what's happening there, yeah. So again, you each character can have entry and exit points. So you need to find if two characters next to each other, and you had then to forget about the vowels in between, yeah. If they have some kind of connecting point, you need to shift them. It is actually more complex because they can be. You have to run over sequence because they all shift relative to each other. So you do two passes, actually. But if you look at the amount of code, the problem is in figuring out what you need to do. It's not so much in writing the code. And of course, at some day I will send Roberto all the files and ask him how it can be done better and faster. Okay, this is, I think, enough for this moment. Yeah? Actually, that is the feature. You know, the features, there are, if you talk about ligatures, some categories of ligatures that you can turn on and off. But as soon as you start doing the contextual analysis, there's not much choice. You are really dependent on language. So what happens there is, for instance, maybe you saw it, dr period. This one. Becomes is, well, actually, there is not even a period anymore. Yeah, it became that good. So there are quite some special things like Mr., Mrs., Senor, Senorita. Some of these things depend, are language dependent, so they really adapt. But if you have bad luck, you need to find out a way to prevent indeed that some of these things happen. So, because, what is DRPB? The
doctor.
No, the guy of the drawings always signs with DR. And so he doesn't want his names to end up. Yeah, so this is something that this is actually one of the reasons why we follow this approach, because it has always been the case that techies can more or less influence what they do, and this makes it possible to implement mechanisms that will give you the control that you want to do.